Hello and welcome to Money, 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 your weekly personal finance date with me, Surabhi Upadhyay. Apple, Amazon, Google, Netflix, Tesla, global blue chip companies that are not only true disruptors, but also Wall Street titans. Now, the recent sell-off in US tech stocks notwithstanding, the question on many of our minds is whether there is merit in playing the global equity story via funds which are available right here in India. So how do you invest in these mutual funds? What is their tax treatment? And is this investment worth the risk? Is it actually worth your while at all? These are some of the questions that we will address on this week's show. Joining me to do that are personal finance experts Harshvardhan Roongta and Kalpesh Asher. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on Money, Money, Money. So I think, the headlines have always been out there, and the fact that we're using a lot of the products created by these companies, it's perhaps making people wonder whether there should be any element of exposure to global stocks, whether it's US blue chips or it's some of the biggest European companies. So let me get first thoughts on whether that's even possible investing via an Indian mutual fund. Harsh, you go first.
Absolutely, Surbhi. So, like the way you invest in your domestic mutual fund schemes, but these mutual funds themselves offer an international fund as well. So the process of investing is as simple as it is to invest in a mutual fund. So you undergo your KYC processes the way you are. You invest in Indian rupees. You give it in the form of a check or your direct debit from a bank. You can set up an SIP into these schemes. So what you're essentially doing is putting money into these schemes, just like you're investing in domestic companies. The fund house invariably takes this money and parks it overseas. So either they could do it in two formats. One is that they buy stocks directly, or they just simply act as a feeder fund wherein the money collected is given into another fund which is operating in the US or the European markets.
Okay.
Now, interestingly, this does not fall under the liberalized remittance scheme, the LRS. It doesn't. This, the limits of $2.5 lakh is also not implied in this case.
So just to sort of clear this up for our viewers, the LRS, as you're mentioning, that allows us Indians, resident Indians, only to invest up to $250,000 in offshore assets in one financial year.
That's correct.
If I'm correct, right?
Correct. So the LRS allows you to remit up to $250,000 outside the country for current or capital account expenditures. Now, this does not fall under that limit also. So this is exclusive of that limit.
Okay.
You don't need any specific RBI permissions because you're investing in Indian rupees in an Indian fund house.
Another important clarification that this is not a dollar investment that you're making. It's a simple investment in Indian currency, where money is rooted and invested in these global companies.
Absolutely.
Kalpesh, let me get your opening thoughts as well. Is it just a fad? Or do you think that there is some merit in looking at your portfolio and giving it maybe a bit of a global exposure as well?
So like Harshvardhan explained, the basic thing which is that we all want to invest in something which we see around us. And things which are giving us a daily, satisfaction or a gratification. Now, going by that line, like what you said earlier, the Amazons of the world or the Facebooks and all those things are all US-based or global-based companies in which we would like to have our share or our participation in.
And not only for emotional reasons, the fact that these stocks, of course, the last couple of weeks have been different, but these stocks have went on to become huge wealth creators.
Absolutely,
in those markets.
Absolutely. So the point is that an evolved investor, and I'm repeating the word an evolved investor, would always like to have his pie in it. So he says that, how do I do it? And then there is a little bit of a conundrum that he faces that, okay, I want to participate through the mutual fund route, which at least has the benefit of a professional fund manager selecting it for me rather than taking the exposure directly. So this evolved investor will only be the person who will be looking at it, not your down the line normal retail investor who wishes to start through the SIP route, because he first will be always looking at starting small.
And understanding
the nuances of the markets, and we talk about balanced funds and large caps of the Indian market. So the simple thing here is that the evolved investor will always look at this portion of his investment portfolio.
Sure.
And more importantly here is that one thing I would like to add here, like Harsh very easily explained the whole thing, that the taxation part on this, that as simple as it looks that we can have a portion of our investments in these international funds. The taxation part is on a debt fund basis.
Okay. So they're not treated like an equity fund, which right now has the 10% long-term capital gains tax.
Yeah.
But a
so
debt
this is
fund.
The 3-year holding period after which you get a 20% with indexation. Though the actual investment done is in the equities.
Is in equity shares.
But you don't get that advantage here.
Okay.
And I think this is a big dampener that when you see the returns also, those get nullified by the debt fund type of a projection.
Okay. So, Harsh, you come in on this, on the taxation and then, you know, whether the risk reward, you know, equation actually makes sense, whether it merits an investment.
So, you know, let's look at the merits of investing into this product. Taxation is one definite consideration to put in, but that is a temporary consideration.
Sure.
The question is, as you mentioned, there are large global giants of whom we are also consumers, like Microsoft, Coca-Cola, for instance, Google, etc. And most certainly they have some kind of income streams which are far, far, you know, attractive in nature. Now, how do I participate in the profits of that company? So I need to be a shareholder of that company. How do I go and buy those shares?
Sure.
Now, this is what we're talking about, global giants whom we are aware of, and they're not listed in India.
Sure.
Now, there are certain other areas or sectors which are not listed in India at all. Like, for example, the defense industry, the privatization of defense services is just now opened up in India. So if I want to bet my money into defense sector, I do not have many options right now.
Okay.
Similarly, in the developed markets such as the US or so, there would be n number of companies in the defense manufacturing sector. So I can take exposure into that. Now, space technology. If I see the next future being space technology, I don't know any Indian company in which I can hold a stake or buy shares into which works in the space technology. Otherwise, I would have companies in the US already working on this. So if I want that kind of exposure into sectors, into companies which are not listed in India, then I can definitely look at investing through these funds because they're convenient.
Okay.
Besides this, I mean, you know, we see a dollar appreciating every year on year. If I'm investing into these companies through an Indian, you know, mutual fund, I ineffectively get the benefit of dollar appreciating also.
Okay.
So a portion of the returns that you see in your in the fund returns also includes a dollar appreciation.
Okay.
Because your investments are eventually in dollars.
But the converse will also be true. I mean, if you happen to be in a year when the dollar is depreciating, then that's the kind of, you know, perhaps risk that you'll have to factor in as well.
Absolutely right.
So,
now, the third point I would also like to you know, emphasize upon this. When you invest out of the country, you're also getting a geographical diversification.
Okay, fair enough. So there are clearly, I mean, arguments on both sides, the merits and the demerits of looking at these funds. The conversation will continue after we take a break. Let's just actually boil it down to the kind of funds, global funds available in the Indian market, their track record, their performance, and then figure out if you should be putting your money in these products. Back in a moment after the break. Welcome back. You're watching Money, Money, Money. And this week we are discussing global funds. How is it that you can take part of the Googles and the Teslas and the Amazons of the world sitting right here in India, investing your money in Indian mutual funds? So let's get down to, you know, brass tacks and the hard numbers. I was looking at some of the, you know, the returns that are out there. For instance, the ICICI Prudential, a U.S. blue chip equity fund, because it's concentrated. It's U.S. It's the biggest companies out there. So over the last 1 year, this fund has returned about 15%, 3 years around 8.5%, and 5 years, the return is 15%. Now, Kalpesh, this is one fund. How do you rate the returns and generally the other funds in this class?
So if you do a broader comparison, like what we said, the Amazons of the world and all the companies probably which are in the S&P 500, and that's the benchmark for this particular fund. So if you see that type of a return and you see the huge number of gigantic profits which they would have made, and you want to be a part of it, and then you analyze it, that what have you got out of it? And when you see the returns, like what you just said, 13% or 8% or 15%, I don't think it makes a very you know, mouth-watering type of a proposition for a person to say that, oh, I'm a part of Amazon, but I just got an 8% return over a 3-year holding period. So it's a bit of a paradox out here. But that's a true fact, and that's the maximum we can do as Indian investors to have our slice of pie in these type of you know, the international funds which we have. So there's a little bit of a reality gap out here which we are facing. That we can very broadly, you know, summarize or actually feel proud about it, that we are being a part of the global cycle. But what matters to us ultimately is the numbers.
No, absolutely. This is money, money, money. We keep it very
so
simple.
We have to be very specific
numbers,
about it, that what do I get at the end of the day?
Absolutely. No, we're going to try and keep emotions aside,
emotions
the joy
aside,
of holding these companies aside. But other funds and the analysis that you've done, Harsh, apart from the ICICI Blue Chip US Equity, What does history tell us? How have they performed?
So if you look at the popularity of the funds, I mean, you know, you would have the major, most of them operating would have less than 100 crores as AUM.
Okay.
So only the Franklin has about 520 crores as an AUM.
This is the feeder fund from
the Franklin India feeder US opportunities fund. So this
has about US centric. So these are US bets that you're
absolutely
taking.
So you know, they have about a 500 plus as an AUM.
Okay.
ICICI and I believe a Kotak would have 100 crores plus.
Kotak is also US blue chip equity.
Absolutely. So so now let's look at the options available. So looking at international global equities, but does not mean that it is all across the world. So the offers, the schemes that are on option, on offer right now, they have either a US equity fund or they would have a European market, or they would concentrate on Asian emerging markets, or they would have some theme based. I mean, they would invest only into consumer oriented companies. They would invest into only mining companies. So there are different options available. All put together, I don't see the AUM in this international fund, entire segment to be more than about 1,500 crores.
Okay.
So let's look at that's the reality right now. Now, the question is, you know, India and emerging markets, let's look at that. So if you are investing into emerging markets, India has the highest and the best potential for growth. So no doubt you need to be in India. You need to invest in India. Being an Indian, you would not invest in India. That's not happening. Some bit of an allocation. And US being, if you had to invest in any other market other than India, then US is the most mature market.
And especially, I mean, I guess if there is some sort of divergence that emerges between the way India is performing and the way US is performing during certain patches. So as we've always said, I mean, this is for the slightly more initiated people who understand equities and mutual funds. But I'm going to go back to the tax question to get back to numbers. So now that we are looking at 20% tax on the return that you're making with the benefit of indexation, how is my net return going to look? Typically, what should I expect?
So if you've looked at the numbers, so as I said, a major component or a major factor of the returns that is being generated is also dollar appreciation. So if you're looking at 13% or a 15% over five years, of that 15%, around 5% would have been because of dollar appreciation. 10% would have been the investment return from a price to price basis.
That's also very important to realize that your actual stock appreciation might not even be 15.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of currency tailwind, which could become a headwind depending on your investment horizon.
Absolutely. Yeah. So from that perspective, there is a lot of forex appreciation that you've got into the 15% that we're talking about.
Okay.
Now, the second element is the taxation. So it is a non-equity scheme because the benefit of a lower taxation is given only on equities which are STT paid. Now, because it's an international equity, there's no STT. So that is the reason it is a non-equity scheme.
Okay.
So that is why it is taxed as debt schemes, which is if you're holding for less than 3 years, all the gains that you've made is going to be added into your income and taxed as per tax slab.
So realistically speaking, Kalpesh, what are the post-tax returns, what should I sort of expect in mind, if at all I invest in these funds?
So ideally speaking, post-tax returns, like Harshvardhan said, that if you're allocating, say, 10 to 15% of your entire portfolio to it, I think it should be in the early double digits. So anything around 10 to 11% post-tax.
Yeah.
I think if you're getting it on a diversified product, I think you should be happy with it. The other thing is, which I would like to add to the whole discussion here, is that when you say global funds, you know, there's, like we said, that almost 25 to 30 funds which are in this category. And if you do the mathematics, it boils down to what he said, around 1,000 to 1,500 crore. In that, there is US, there is China, there is Japan, there is Brazil, and the entire spectrum of countries. Now, you wouldn't put your money anywhere except a US, which you know that at least this is the one which is the most stable out of the entire lot. So the whole choice narrows down to ultimately a US vis-a-vis an India.
Okay, so I'm going to end this part of our conversation quickly with your top fund ideas for those who are willing to go ahead, take the risk and want a bit of diversification. Your top global fund choices then.
So I would bet my money on the ICICI US blue chip fund. That is if I want direct equity investors. I'm a fund manager to pick up equities directly. Or I can go in for a Franklin India feeder fund, which basically it collects the money in India and just goes and invests into a US-based mutual fund of Franklin itself. Or the third option, if I want an index, like I'm always a fan of index funds. So Motilal Oswal has a NASDAQ 100 ETF, so which basically just replicates the NASDAQ 100 stocks.
Concentrated bet you're taking then. Technology, US tech. So if it works, it works. If it doesn't, then make sure that you're ready to digest that as well. In terms of returns from these three choices, what's been the best of the lot off late?
So off lately, Franklin has done well.
Okay.
But I would want to, again, emphasize on the fact that it's a US-based, so I'm assuming that the US US fund managers know exactly what is happening locally there. So it's a good idea to just collect money from here and give it to them over there.
Okay.
So that is one of the top performing and also has the highest AUM. So.
Okay, absolutely. Kalpesh, I know you're being far more prudent with this, but if you were to put in some money, then
So it's the same one, which, okay. as I said, the choice narrows down to the ICICI Prudential US Blue Chip Equity Fund. And in that, because it covers the entire S&P 500, and I've seen Amazon on the top of the list. So I think that takes the cake.
Okay, all right, gentlemen. We're going to take a quick break on that note. But on the other side, I mean, if you don't want to get into US or Europe or whatever, you want to just keep it simple right here in India, top fund ideas coming up for you after the break. Welcome back. You're watching Money, 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 and we have just had a lengthy discussion on global funds, investing in global equities, particularly US blue chip equity. Now, if you don't want to do that, and if you just want to talk about what is happening back here at home, then our experts have some fund recommendations for you as always. You know, we're still in the early part of the new financial year. So, Kalpesh, good idea. Let's get your top three equity fund ideas then.
Okay, so my top three equity ideas for the year going around. First of all, I would like to have the ICICI Prudential Focused Blue Chip Equity Fund. The reason I like this fund is primarily because from its inception, this is the only large cap fund which has stuck to its pure fundamentals. Mm-hmm. And even today, if you see that it's got 98% in the giant and the large cap category. Mm. So I like the funds which stick to their benchmark, don't deviate, because if you want a different type of a fund, there are in the other category. You don't have to look for it in the same family.
Okay.
So that's the ICICI Prudential Focused Blue Chip in the large cap category. In the multi cap category, I've got two choices. In fact, I would like to have a word of recommendation for the ICICI Prudential Nifty Next 50 Fund. So it's pure index fund.
That's an index fund.
It's a pure index fund. But the composition of this next 50, which is after the top 50, is that even today, it's got a good exposure to FMCG.
Okay.
And if you see that, that's the theme, the consumption theme.
It's been doing very well.
Yeah. And you don't have to really break your head about what the funds to choose and everything. It just replicates.
And most of these are well-researched stocks.
Very well-researched stocks. So if you just pull out the fact sheet, you'll get to know why this is recommended. Low-cost fund, no other hassles. Mm. And on a parallel note, even in the multi-cap category, the Aditya Birla Sun Life Equity Fund. And that fund has been a real great performer over the last 2-3 years. And it has changed its bets according to the situation.
Mm.
And even that fund... for now, at least has a decent exposure between financials and the FMCG sector.
Yeah, I'm seeing the 5-year return. So it's nicely, handsomely outperformed its benchmark BSE 200.
Exactly,
22-23% return coming
in. So taking a dual call in the multi-cap category, let's see what the index does vis-a-vis what an active fund does. Mm. And the last one which I would like to have is the Reliance Small Cap. And this is surely for people who have a 10-year horizon and like a 5 to 10-year horizon. And a very well researched fund in the small cap category. And earlier it was helmed by Sunil Singhania. Now it's somebody else. But I'm sure the fundamentals haven't changed for that fund. So these four funds would be my top bits.
Top equity funds. Okay, there you go. You have lots of ideas coming in from Kalpesh. Some thoughts from you as well, Harsh?
So, well, I'll put this into three categories. Of course, the large cap oriented fund. So my pick would be a Birla Frontline Equity Fund. Now, this has been in existence for a considerably long time. It has seen the bear phase, it has seen the bull phase, and it has, in fact, outperformed in all the last 10 to almost 13 years now.
Mm-hmm.
So it has outperformed its benchmark, it has outperformed the peers.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is that if I'm putting my money into a portfolio like this, mm-hmm. and the fund is managed by Mahesh Patil and he has a proven track record.
Sure.
So that is one of my picks.
Okay. That's a large cap oriented.
They would have a small exposure in mid cap. I mean, it would be 10 to 15%.
Okay.
The third that I would add is a multi cap.
Okay.
So in that category, I'll pick the SBI Multicap Fund
mm-hmm.
for one reason, that they are genuinely a multicap. They would have allocations between large and midcap, which are almost equal.
Mm.
So they would not, get swayed by the fact that midcaps are, overvalued in that context.
Mm.
So we might just let's start moving towards large cap.
Okay.
So well, if I've picked a multicap fund, I would want you to also pick up good midcap companies. If a mandate of a multi-cap fund would be very simple, that you pick something which is at good valuation.
Okay, fair enough. So that's pure equity. Any thoughts on the hybrid side as well? Any ideas there?
Yeah, so I have a choice there. I like the HDFC Balanced Fund. And as I mentioned, that I like funds which stick to their mandate.
Mm.
And the HDFC Balanced Fund here sticks to its mandate of, having an exposure of around 65 to 70% in the equity part, primarily consisting of large caps. because you don't want a high risk in a balanced fund, basically, in the equity component of it. And right now, it is in the debt part of it, which it's managing. Although the calls have not been quite right, it still has an exposure to the G-Secs and the long duration one, which I'm sure the fund manager would take cognizance of and, you know,
Because I hear on the debt side people saying stick to accrual funds right now.
Yeah, stick to accrual funds. But this has some part of it. But overall, it has still not impacted the performance of this particular fund.
Okay.
So HDFC Balanced Fund, because of its sticking to its philosophy and keeping a safe portfolio in the balanced fund category, I like that one.
Okay. Any final recommendations or thoughts? Any other fund ideas?
So on the hybrid side or, you know, on the conservative side, an ICSA balanced advantage fund is something very interesting. You know, it is for those kind of investors who want to, who have a lump sum to invest, but they feel the market valuations are not good enough. At the same time, they are not sure whether there's a good time to invest or no. You know, so putting all those, possibilities into the scheme, a balanced advantage fund moves between an equity exposure of, say, 30% to 80%.
Correct. According to the algorithm, the market values, it automatically keeps on adjusting its
And
positions.
It is an equity oriented fund because the balance, the remaining amount to qualify to be an equity fund is invested into arbitrage, equity arbitrage products. So in all, it's a tax efficient product. And at the same time, it gives the comfort that you're not buying something or you don't have exposure into equity irrespective of the market.
Sure.
So if you're in a pure balanced fund, you have to mandatorily be 65 to 70% in equities.
Yes.
Whether you like it or not.
Correct.
In this case, my direct equity exposure will come down to 30%.
Right.
And still, I would be an equity fund.
Okay.
So this is one, in times of volatility, in times of uncertainty, this kind of fund works as a safe haven there.
Okay, so final thoughts then, since we've discussed both products, the balanced fund and the balanced advantage fund, which is basically dynamic asset allocation, what should my return expectations be from both of these products?
So, you know, a 10% on the lower side for sure. I mean, if anything gives you less than 10%, you're not in the right product in that case.
Okay. All right, gentlemen, thank you very much. Lots of interesting ideas there from global to local. Thanks very much for joining us on the show today. Well, your feedback, questions, queries, welcome as always. We will see you again next week.